Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson 54 of the platform-specific series of my Z80 programming tutorials. Today we're going to be looking at the Amstrad CPC and some of the techniques we can use to achieve transparent effects on the Amstrad CPC. Of course, the CPC has no hardware sprites, so anything that gets put to the screen is the result of our work. So if we want transparency, we can have it, and if we don't, then we don't have it. But as I say, if we want to have transparent effects so that our sprites don't have a sort of clunky border on them, then we're going to have to find some way of doing that. And I wanted to discuss the various options that are available to us and the pros and cons of doing so. Now, you can see on screen here, the first option for transparency is simply to not have it. Now, we've got our character Eureta here, and it's been drawn three times to the screen. And you can see that if we use some kind of transparency, we should be able to see three copies. But on this example here, we can see that the legs and the torso here have been completely blanked out because we've got no transparency, and our sprite is effectively a sort of rectangle here, and any area that's color zero has just been bleached out. So no transparency, we lose a lot of detail there, and the other two back here look quite weird indeed. Now, a great simple way of achieving transparency on a system like this is to use color zero, and when the byte is color zero, we simply skip over that byte. The pro of this is it's pretty fast and it gives us some pretty decent transparency. It's quite good on mode zero. It's okay on mode one as well. This is what Chibiakum has used when it used transparency. And you can see here that it looks okay. We can now see our three ureters. But if you look around the legs, you'll see there's this kind of blocky effect, because if either of the pixels is not zero, then both pixels aren't drawn to the screen because we're working at the byte level, and on mode zero, there's two pixels per byte. So that does have that disadvantage there. Now, the advanced mode is to actually have a more clever way of doing it, so that if either pixel is zero, only that pixel is skipped and the drawn pixel is actually drawn. And you can see now we have basically perfect transparency here, and that will give us a great effect in mode zero. If we're working in mode one, these effects would of course work, but shedding an entire color for the transparency in Chibiakumas wouldn't have worked. In Chibiakumas, I used the byte zero transparency. This meant that if both pixels were zero, the byte was skipped, but this was perfectly acceptable because I wanted a black cartoon border around my characters anyway. And in the few cases I needed to use color zero, I actually had a trick where I could swap in an alternative byte parameter, so I could compare to color 255 or weird combinations of patterns. So I actually had a bit of a workaround for that. But if you're using mode one and you can spare some memory, your alternative is to use a mask. You would effectively define two sprites. One would be your actual color, and then one would be a mask to define which parts of the background needed to be kept and which needed to be removed. And this would be in color three being where all the bits are one, you see. And so the black areas here will be deleted from the background, and then the color will be drawn on the top, and that will give us a character with a nice smooth black outline defined by the mask. But it does mean you need twice as much memory, one part of memory for the mask and one part of memory for the sprite. So it's not necessarily the best option for you, but it's certainly a viable option. And as I say, while using this option is great for mode zero, it's not going to be very good for mode one, unless you only really need color zero for the background, which as I say is probably not going to be appropriate. Well, okay then, so let's fire up today's source code example and we'll see it in action, and then we'll have a quick discussion about it. So we'll just compile here with F9, and then if we go over to our window here and do call and 1200, and here's our example. Now these are the exact same images you just saw. So you can see that the first example here up in the top left is no transparency at all. And you can see that the legs and the torso of the background characters has been completely destroyed. Now below that, you can see the best quality example just down here. And you can see that the characters are perfectly represented at the pixel level. There's no damage to the background versions. Whereas the one on the right here, you can see this is the byte zero transparency, where if both pixels are zero, the byte is skipped. But you can see around the legs, there's this kind of blocky border, which doesn't look very nice and has negatively affected the background, but it is a faster way of doing things. It saves a little bit of memory as well. So that's your simple but effective transparency. Okay, so those are the three options we're going to be looking at, and we'll discuss them now. Now, all of these are basically based on our original simple bitmap example, and we've got a few different routines here. We've got draw sprite, which is our simple example, draw sprite Z, and which is the 0-byte example, and DOSBytet, which uses a lookup table for transparency, and we'll discuss how that works in just a moment. So here's the simple draw sprite. We're just looping around for each of the lines of our sprite, 64 lines, and each byte, there's 8 bytes wide, and we're just reading in source bytes from the bitmap and drawing them to the screen in HL here, and we're just repeating until our sprite's done. So that's the simple version. The zero version isn't much more complicated. We read in from DE here, and we just do an OR A to update the flags, and if the zero flag is set because the byte was zero, we never draw it to the screen here. And that's all we have to do to achieve the zero transparency, and that's why it's so efficient. Now, if you preferred, rather than zero being the transparent color, you could do a byte CP255, and then a byte that was entirely 255 would be the transparent one, or something like that. As I say, you can use a different color if that's what you want to do, but this is going to be the most efficient if you can sacrifice that zero color. So that's how we can use a whole byte, and if this byte is zero, we just skip over it. The final one is the transparent with a lookup table. So let's have a look at that lookup table. Now, the lookup table is down here. The lookup table is 256 bytes, and it's byte aligned to 256. And what this means is the top byte of the address will be some number that we don't know, the assembler will work it out, but the bottom byte will start at 0 and go all the way to 255. And what we're going to do is we're going to calculate for each of those addresses the equivalent. Is if that bottom byte was a pixel, we're going to work out the equivalent mask to remove the background that's going to be covered up by that pixel. And what we can do by doing that is take the pixel from the sprite that we want to draw to the screen, look at the equivalent offset within that lookup table, and use that as a mask to remove the background, and then OR in the sprite, and that will give us perfect transparency, no corruption of the background. The only cost is a few extra lines of code in our sprite drawing routine and the 256 byte lookup table to do the conversion. So that's pretty good. Now, of course, the first thing we need to do is set up the lookup table, because the way I've set it up here, by default, it would just be full of zeros. So we need to actually do some calculation. And what we want to do is we want to fill each entry of the lookup table with a mask to retain the background as required, depending on the pixel we want to plot to the screen. Now, if the byte we want to plot to the screen is actually just a 0 byte, then we have no pixels to draw to the screen because we're defining color 0 as our transparent color. So the first entry of our lookup table will just be all ones, because that will retain the entire background. We're going to draw nothing over the top. But in all of the situations, we need to work out what we want to plot to the screen over the top. Now, in the case that the right pixel is 0, we're going to want to retain the right pixel of the background. If the case is that the left pixel is 0, we're going to want to retain the left pixel of the background. And if neither of the pixels are 0, we want to retain none of the background. And the none of the background case is going to be this lookup table containing a 0, which it does by default. So what we need to do is we need to look at each of these combinations and the bits that make up that color. And then if that condition is set, then we need to actually fill in the table with the correct combination to lose that part of the background. So what we're doing here is we're seeing if any of the bits that make up the right pixel are set, and if none of them are, then that color is 0 and that needs to be transparent. So we're writing the combination to keep that part of the background into the lookup table. But if that wasn't the case, we're then checking the left pixels here and seeing if any of those bits that make up the left pixel are set. And if none of them are, then we are setting to retain only that pixel of the background. If we branched over through to here though, then both of the pixels are actually have some kind of color in mode 0. So we're just going to leave the lookup table containing a 0, and that's what we're going to need to clear away the background in our code further on. So that's how we've defined our lookup table and filled it with the values. Now, when it comes to actually employing that table, we're going to be using another register. We've kind of swapped around here. We're using IXH now to free up BC, because BC is a faster register, of course. So we're loading BC with the address of the lookup table. But then when we want to get the transparent information, we're loading in from the accumulator the bitmap data that we want to draw to the screen. We're then loading that byte into the C part of the address, because the lookup table is byte aligned. And then by reading in from our lookup table, we're getting the equivalent mask to remove the background of the colored pixels of the byte we just read in. We AND the background with that mask, which effectively removes the parts where the bits are zero, and those are going to be the equivalent bits that we want to draw on the top. We then OR in the byte that we read in from our sprite data, and we write that back to the screen. And this has effectively cleared the background, put the sprite in over the cleared part, and now we're ready to continue again. And that's all we need to do to use this lookup table. So you can see there's only a few extra commands in here over the top of the zero one. It's going to be a little bit slow, and if you're using big sprites, that's going to start mattering. But as I say, this is going to be pretty fast, and it only needs that 256 byte lookup table. And I actually looked at Operation Wolf, the source code of the Amstrad version, and this is effectively what that is doing to do the transparency. I'm sure a lot of other games do this as well in the same way. So it's certainly worth you looking at as a way of doing transparency in mode zero. Now, when it comes to mode one, that's not going to be particularly good for you. As I said before, mode one, you don't really want to be losing an entire color, and you're probably going to want to be able to use that extra color as for sort of surrounding your sprites. As I said, you would want some kind of image like this where your three colors are being used for your character, and then the background is left alone, but you have the background color, the color zero, as well as part of the sprite. And you can do this by defining a mask sprite and a color sprite, which, as I say, is going to double up your sprite information, but you know, some sacrifice is going to have to be made. And so if we compile that here now, and if I do call 1200 here, you can see we've got our three characters here, but you can see also that the background, if you look at the power DOS here, you can see, you can still see the text around the character's legs there, and the basic as well around the feet. So the background has been retained according to our mask, and we can now use color zero as an actual color and not just as a transparent color. And let's have a look at how we've done that. Well, the first thing is I've defined two sprites, and I made both of them with my AcuSprite editor, which is free and open source. And all we're doing here is we've got this new function called draw sprite mask. Now this is using a pair, and it's writing both parts at the same time. So I'm having to use IY here, which is going to be a little bit slower, but it's better than doing two loops. So I'm loading in the test sprite address with IY and the test mask with DE here. So we're loading in a byte from the mask from DE into the accumulator here. We're then ANDing the current destination byte that we want to draw to the screen. This is effectively removing the black parts of the mask from the background screen. And then we're ORing in the new color that we want to show in the sprite in IY. And then we're storing the resulting byte back to the screen. So we're reading in from the mask, clearing the background using the mask, ORing in the color, storing back to the screen background. And then we're just increasing all of our counters here. And then we are just repeating for the line and then repeating for the next line of the screen. So that's going to be a pretty efficient way of doing things. Now you can see I'm using IY and DE here. Now, if you were going to be super clever, maybe you could kind of byte align things a bit more efficiently so that you weren't updating both bytes here. But as I say, this is the sort of best that I could do with a simple example here. I think that gives a pretty decent way of achieving a good transparency though on the four color Amstrad CPC mode. And I think that's a good reason why you might want to use mask sprites within your games. So anyway, that's the example for today. We've seen a couple of different options for sprite transparency, and none of them are particularly scary once you've seen the code to do them. All of the code for today's examples is downloadable from my website, of course, and all the sprites you saw today were made with my free open source AcuSprite editor. So if that's any use to you, please go ahead and download it. Anyway, that's what we're going to be covering today. I hope you found it interesting. If you did, please like and subscribe. If you didn't, please take a look around the website and the YouTube channel, because there's lots of other platforms I cover. I'm covering Z80, 6502, 68000, a wide variety of systems on all of those CPUs. I'm also covering ARM at 8086 now, so maybe those are more interesting to you. But whatever you do, I hope you enjoy programming, and I hope you enjoy the Amstrad CPC. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.